Welcome, Lifesavers, to the Cardiovascular Pathophysiology video. This is Nurse Kelly Tyrrell here. So in today's video, we are going to take a deep dive into the cardiovascular system because you'll have to understand how this robust body system works and functions in order to be able to identify abnormalities. The cardiovascular system is composed of the heart and a complex collection of blood vessels, which is used to deliver useful substances throughout the body. So these blood vessels carry oxygen from the lungs, nutrients from the gut, white blood cells to protect against infection, and life-sustaining hormones to the tissues of the body. The blood is also essential in the removal of waste products and will transport the waste products to other organs, mainly the liver and the kidney, so that way they can filter them and excrete those toxins. The heart is a complex muscular pump that contracts to push blood throughout the body's network of vessels. Arteries and vessels carry blood away from the heart, and veins take blood back to the heart. So arteries branch off into tiny vessels, which are known as arterioles and capillaries. The tiny capillary vessels that take blood away from the heart eventually connect with a large network of veins and venules that will then circulate the blood back to the heart. The circulation of the heart can be divided into two parts. You have the pulmonary circulation and the systemic circulation. So the pulmonary circulation carries blood that is pumped by the right side of the heart to the lungs, and the systemic circulation carries blood pumped by the more powerful left side of the heart to the rest of the body. The pressure in the pulmonary circulation is relatively low to prevent that fluid from being forced out of the capillaries into the alveoli of the lungs. The pressure in the systemic circulation, which is what is measured with a blood pressure cuff when you're assessing blood pressure, however, is much higher, which makes sense because the systemic circulation has to be able to push out that blood through the rest of your body all the way to your brain, into all of your other organs, and out to your fingers and toes. So now let's talk about the actual structures of arteries, veins, and capillaries, which make up blood vessels within the cardiovascular system. So the heart contracts continuously, which allows for blood to move through these vast network of blood vessels. So again, arteries carry blood away from the heart to the organs and tissues, whereas veins carry blood back to the heart. I always remembered that arteries and away both start with A. This helps me to remember which direction blood flows through arteries and which direction blood flows through the veins. Both arteries and veins have walls that are made up of three layers. The innermost lining called the tunica intima, the middle lining called the tunica media, and the outer wrapping called the tunica adventitia. While the tunica media is very thick lining in the arteries, it's very thin in the veins and absent in the capillaries. So the thick walls and elastic nature of the arteries means that they can withstand the high pressure that occurs when the heart contracts and also to keep blood flowing between each heartbeat. Veins have much thinner walls than arteries and contain less muscle and more connective and elastic tissue. Capillaries converge to form tiny veins or venules, which then join them up to form larger veins. And most veins contain pocket-like valves to keep blood flowing in the right direction. Lastly, capillaries are extremely thin and are formed by just a single layer of flattened cells. This actually allows substances to easily transfer between the blood inside the capillary and some of the surrounding tissue. Some of the capillaries even have pores or fenestrations, they're called, to make the exchange of substances even easier. Now we're going to go into how the components of the cardiovascular system actually work, including the blood, the cardiac cycle, controlling the heart, and the blood vessels. So let's start with the blood itself. So blood and its components are produced in the bone marrow, and there are four different blood types which are actually hereditary. So blood type is determined by the proteins called antigens, which are located on the surface of the blood. The four blood types are A, B, AB, and O. O blood has no antigens, which is why it's considered the universal blood. So anyone of any blood type can get it. Adults have approximately 11 pints of blood circulating through their body. That's about 5 liters at any given time. The main function of the blood is to supply cells in our body with nutrients and oxygen, and blood also removes the cell's waste products. Other functions of the blood include transporting hormones and antibodies and cells that actually fight infection. So blood is the main transport system of the body. The heart pumps all 11 pints around the body every single minute. So during the transportation of blood, blood components pick up nutrients absorbed from the gut as well as oxygen from the lungs, which then get delivered to the body's cells. Blood is also responsible for the removal of waste and chemicals from cells such as urea and lactic acid. These waste products and chemicals are then transported to the liver and kidneys to be further broken down and later excreted through the urine and or stool. Carbon dioxide that is removed by the blood is then transported to the lungs where it's excreted as we exhale during breathing. Cells and other substances involved in healing and fighting infection, such as white blood cells, circulate in the bloodstream and only become active when they are actually needed. So this is why when you're fighting an infection, you'll often see that the white blood cell count will be skyrocketed, it'll be elevated. So now let's move on and talk about the components of the blood. So the blood is composed of three different parts. The first part is plasma, which is a straw-colored liquid that forms the largest part of the blood, and it makes up about 54% of the total blood volume. The second part are the white blood cells and the platelets. So these cells play a crucial role in immunity and clotting, and they only make up about 1% of the total blood volume. There are many types of white blood cells called leukocytes that exist within the body, and they are actually the key to our immunity, fighting infections, triggering allergic reactions, and removing foreign bodies in our blood. Platelets are important for blood clotting and are cell fragments produced in the bone marrow from larger cells called megakaryocytes. Platelets actually lack a nucleus, so therefore they only last in the body for about 8 to 12 days, but don't worry, new platelets are constantly being regenerated in the bone marrow every single day. So when a blood vessel becomes damaged, platelets actually rush to the damaged site to plug the gap. As they start adhering to the damaged area, they release specialized chemicals, which then trigger what is called the clotting or coagulation cascade. So this results in the formation of strands of a protein called fibrin, which link up the platelets to form a large clot and traps the platelets and red blood cells within that clot. So to summarize, when you cut yourself, platelets rush to fill the gap. Then they release chemicals, which triggers the clotting cascade and the formation of fibrin strands. These fibrin strands form a clot, which traps the platelets and red blood cells within that clot. All right, next let's talk about red blood cells. So these cells are vital in carrying oxygen throughout the body to other cells, and they make up about 45% of the total blood volume. The primary liquid component of blood is called plasma, and this is actually made up of 92% water, and it also contains minerals like glucose, enzymes, hormones, and other waste products, including carbon dioxide, urea, and lactic acid. Plasma also contains antibodies that fight infection. All right, so now that we understand what blood is and how it's composed, let's move on and talk about how it is that blood is circulated throughout our bodies. Well, blood is circulated through a process known as the cardiac cycle. So the heart is a two-sided muscular pump that is responsible for circulating all of that blood throughout our body. And it's made up of 4 chambers and 4 main valves. The 2 upper chambers are the left and right atria, and the 2 lower chambers are the left and right ventricles. In between each chamber, you have 4 valves, 2 at the exit of the atria called the mitral and tricuspid valve, and 2 at the exit of the ventricles called the aortic and pulmonic valves, which open and close during that cardiac cycle. So these valves have specialized attachments called papillary muscle fibers and chordae tendinae fibers, which prevent the valves from opening backward into the atria and ventricles when pressure rises during the cardiac cycle. So when there is a lack of these fibers present in the valves, you experience something called cardiac regurgitation, which means that the valves do not stay closed when they should, and it allows for the backflowing of blood into the heart. So this can require surgery to actually replace the affected valve if the regurg is that bad. The right side of the heart receives deoxygenated blood through the superior vena cava and the inferior vena cava into the right atrium. The heart then pumps that deoxygenated blood to the lungs through the pulmonary artery, where it's mixed with oxygen. The left side of the heart then receives all of that oxygen-rich blood from the lungs through that pulmonary vein, and it's then pumped around to the rest of the body through the aorta. When at rest, the heart beats on average 100,000 times per day. Wow, that is a lot of heartbeats. And with every heartbeat involves the coordination of a contraction, also known as systole, and relaxation known as diastole. So these coordinated muscle pulses are what actually allows the blood to transfer from the upper two chambers, known as the atria, into the lower two chambers, known as the ventricles. And then in between these chambers, you have a system of valves which help to eject the blood from the heart to the aorta and the pulmonary artery. There are five stages to the cardiac cycle. So let's go ahead and review those stages now. So stage one is gonna be that diastole. So at this stage, the ventricles are relaxed. In the early stage of diastole, the mitral and tricuspid valves open and blood that has been building up in the atria during systole rapidly rushes into the ventricles. After this happens, blood returning to the heart flows passively from the atria into the ventricles. And at the end of stage one, the ventricles will be about 75% full of blood. Next, we move on to stage two, known as atrial systole. So in this stage, the right and left atria contract simultaneously, which forces any remaining blood through the mitral and tricuspid valves into the relaxed ventricles. So after atrial systole, the ventricles are now 100% full. Even though the contraction of the atria has only contributed to 25% of that volume, because remember in stage one, the ventricles were already filled up to 75% capacity. So now we enter into stage three, which is the isovolumic contraction. So this is the first stage of systole when the muscles of the ventricles start to contract and increase the pressure on the blood within the ventricles. So the increased pressure is actually enough to close the mitral and tricuspid valves, which were previously open in stage one, but the pressure isn't yet great enough to open that aortic and pulmonary valves. So next we move into stage four, which is known as the ejection stage. Eventually the ventricular contraction from the last stage gets stronger and stronger until the pressure builds up so much within the ventricles that it exceeds the pressure of the blood in the aorta and the pulmonary arteries. So once this happens, the aortic and pulmonary valves are forced open and the blood is powerfully ejected from the ventricles. So that powerful ejection is what's going to actually push all of that blood volume through your entire body. And then after ejection occurs, we move into the final stage of the cardiac cycle, which is known as the isovolumic relaxation stage. So this is actually the earliest stage of diastole, and the heart is preparing to go through all of those five stages again. So the ventricles start to relax, and the pressure of the blood in the ventricle starts falling, which allows for that aortic and pulmonary valves to actually close. So at this point, the mitral and tricuspid valves, they stay closed until the cycle repeats, and then they start to relax and open in stage one. So now that we just reviewed how the heart pumps blood through our body, now we have to understand what actually makes the heart go through that cardiac cycle. So the answer to that question is actually through a process called cardiac conduction system. So the heart beats around 70 times per minute, although this varies dramatically throughout the day depending on what you're doing and your activity level is. So the heart rate is finely tuned by a bunch of nerves and circulating hormones that work to ensure the speed is just right to provide all of the cells in the body with all of the blood that they need. The cardiac conduction system consists of very specialized cells that transport electrical impulses through the cardiac muscle in order to trigger that contraction. The impulse for each heartbeat starts in the SA node, which is located in that right atrium. Which makes sense because if you remember, we said that deoxygenated blood first enters through the right side of the heart into the right atrium. So the SA node is also called the pacemaker of the heart, and it emits an electrical impulse that runs through the atrial walls and stimulates atrial systole, which is stage 2 in the cardiac cycle. Electricity cannot pass directly between the atria and the ventricles, so instead it's channeled into a pathway called the AV node, where it's delayed slightly to ensure that the atrial contraction is over before the ventricles start to contract again. So after leaving the AV node, the electrical impulses rushes through a specialized network of fibers called the bundle of His and Purkinje fibers. These specialized networks of fibers are conduction fibers that run through the walls of the ventricles and stimulate the contraction of those ventricles. So just remember, the SA node stimulates the atrium to contract and the AV node stimulates the ventricles to contract. The heart's electrical activity can be recorded using something called an electrocardiogram, or an ECG for short. During an ECG, electrodes are positioned on the chest and limbs in such a way that electrical currents in all areas of the heart can actually be captured. So the ECG recording displays the voltage between each electrode. In a typical ECG rhythm strip, each heartbeat produces three distinct waves. There's a P wave, a QRS wave, and a T wave. Normal electrical conduction in the heart would depict a rhythm strip called normal sinus rhythm. So the P wave shows the electrical impulses that spread from the SA node through the atria to the AV node. The QRS complex shows the electrical activity continuing from the AV node through the ventricles to produce a ventricular contraction. And lastly, the T wave represents the electrical recovery or repolarization of the ventricles. So at this point, both the atria and the ventricles relax completely. Now, if you can understand how a rhythm strip reflects the electrical activity within the heart and where the electrical impulses are located in the heart, it will help you tremendously to understand how to read and interpret EKG rhythm strips. So for example, if you have an atrial dysrhythmia, such as atrial fibrillation, you will have an absence or abnormality of the P wave, since the P wave represents atrial activity. If you have a ventricular arrhythmia, such as ventricular tachycardia or ventricular fibrillation, you will have an abnormality or absence of the QRS complex, because that QRS complex represents ventricular contractions. And that concludes the end of this lesson. I hope that you found this information extremely valuable and it made you just a little more confident as you prepare to take your NCLEX. I just want to thank you so much again, Lifesavers, for tuning in today. My name is Nurse Kelly Tyrrell, and I help nurses feel more confident, increase their test scores, and retain what they don't remember in nursing school. If this video helped you in any way, be sure to give it a thumbs up. Also, don't forget to smash that subscribe button and click that notification bell so you don't miss out on any of my upcoming content and future videos. And why don't you go ahead and do me a favor and drop me a comment below. Just let me know where you're at with your nursing journey. I'd love to say hi and just connect with you. Also, make sure you click that share icon to spread the word and encourage a fellow aspiring nurse. And last but not least, when you are ready to take your NCLEX, be sure to check out my NCLEX and Show review, where I help eliminate test anxiety and review detailed test taking strategies so you can have that unfair advantage to pass your exam on your very next attempt. Not ready to end the study sesh yet? Well, you are in luck, because if you stick around, you can watch more of my videos coming at you in 3, 2, 1. Bye, Lifesavers.